welcome. This week, as Narendra Modi dominates the political grammar in the capital, we take a look at the enigma of his arrival. But first, the interview of the week with Congress spokesperson Sandeep Dikshit. We talk to him about the inevitable Rahul Modi face-off and the Congress strategy to handle Narendra Modi. Sandeep Dikshit's grandfather, Uma Shankar Dikshit, was Indira Gandhi's confidant. His mother, Sheila Dikshit, is a three-term chief minister of Delhi. But Sandeep worked in an NGO and politics is not his first profession of choice. Currently, however, he is the party's chief whip in parliament and also its most politically correct spokesperson. The low-profile Dikshit emerged into prominence when he was one of the key negotiators with Team Anna. Currently, Dikshit is now an intrinsic player of Rahul's core team. Hello and welcome to Cover Story. Sandeep, you know, just in neighboring Uttar Pradesh, we're having this riots even now as we are speaking, but no reaction from Rahul Gandhi. He's made two election speeches in Delhi and in Rajasthan. A, shouldn't he have gone to Uttar Pradesh? And secondly, why is he not referring to these riots, not condemning them?
See, first of all, there's been a very clear condemnation of the violence on behalf of the Home Minister of the party in Uttar Pradesh. And remember, the party in Uttar Pradesh is led by the PCC president there, by Shri Prakash Jaiswalji, who's a minister. The Prime Minister has spoken and expressed his concern.
But Rahul is the most high-profile MP.
This is not the time to play politics, you know. I have a feeling that whenever there is a situation like this, it is time to express calm, to ask for people to calm down, to ensure that peace happens. And it is only after that that the post-mortem should start. And I think there's been some maturity that Rahulji has shown by not doing this. You know, local leaders have made their statements. But if at this time you kind of make a political statement, I think it's only going to exacerbate a situation. So I think let's just wait, because there is this terrible thing that's happening there. It doesn't seem to be abating right now, but hopefully maybe another day or so things should get into control. And then let's see who says what.
But you know, like for instance, Digvijay Singh, let's look at the last few weeks. There's been this VHP Yatra. Then now we have this situation of riots where you can see there is a communalization and polarization.
See, there is a very clear pattern. Yes. There is a very clear pattern. Not just now, for a while now. There have been stray instances from across India. I also remember long time back, the Home Minister or somebody senior in the government also stating that there are different intelligence reports which show that fundamentalist and communal forces, especially from the right wing, may be trying to, add some fuel to fire wherever small situations occur. First of all, you know, rioting cannot take place where there is no other something that may have happened. So in this case, for example, things happened almost 20 days back, but then people kept that fire alive. So I think there is also intelligence information, and I believe that maybe there is a dangerous pattern, if somebody observed it more closely, to what's been happening both in Uttar Pradesh and in other parts of India.
So this dangerous pattern, do you see it being linked to one particular person?
I would say it is linked to one particular strategy, right? There is a particular group of institutions that have always believed in certain ideologies, and as time to time, whenever time favors fundamentalist forces to come up, they've always used those excuses to light and stoke fires. And I think it's part of their strategy now to use what they did in the late 80s and early 90s to go back to that old scenario. Suddenly this Yatra in Ayodhya, the fact that you start talking of different articles of the constitution that you had earlier said that you will drop from your manifesto, suddenly talking about the Ram temple, which you said is no longer part of your manifesto because you are in a coalition government. And remember, they are still in a coalition. So starting to get back all those old points, starting to project a particular person as the hero of a particular religion with violent connotations attached to a particular personality rather than peaceful connotations. Remember, they are still in a coalition. So to try and portray as if certain communities in this country need the man with a sword, on kind of a horseback, saying, I'll save you in a manner. So I think this whole portrayal that's happening is subtle. Yet it's, I think, something where you're trying to, build a sense of fear in people of a particular community on either side. and then reap a political harvest out of that.
So basically, this is we're talking about Modi. I mean, there's no doubt about
Maybe
that.
As I just said, I would not like to put it on one person. I would like to say it's part of a strategy by a group of institutions who have tremendous political ambitions. The reason I would not like to put it on one person is I don't believe any one person is capable. And by putting it on one person, you cannot shift the blame away from the entire institutions that are actually involved in this process.
Okay, but ever since, say, the projection of Modi as the PM candidate, there has been a greater emphasis, aggression in the BJP, attempt in polarizing the votes.
Because, you know, one of the things that this gentleman carries is the fact that, you know, he's truly, a believer in a particular ideology that wants a very different India to come up, right? And, you also get a captain of a team that believes in a particular strategy, as opposed to that strategy works better. So they are trying to do that, and I think they have found that everything else hasn't worked. Whenever their governments at the center have come, their whole demand for development couldn't get through. Even in Gujarat, for example, I've seen a very, very interesting pattern. Gujarat used to be touted as this example of development. Once the Congress and our spokesperson punctured that, in the last 3 or 4 public meetings, there is not a single statement on Gujarat and its great growth story. In fact, they are now talking of all kinds of, extraneous issues, some A, B, C, D, some Gujarat, things here and there. And then, of course, this communalization issue. So when they realize that ultimately their, their propaganda of development doesn't cut through, they're going back to their absolutely primordial instincts.
But they're also saying these are the instincts that brought them to power in the 90s. You know, it was soon after the Riots, soon after this. So there is a certain logic.
That's what I'm saying. There is a pattern again that we can see. That pattern brought them from 2 seats to 200. And they believe that that pattern will once again, give them some political benefit.
Also, I've noticed, Digvijay Singh actually first talked about it soon after this 84 Kosi Yatra. He said this is a match fixing between the SP and the BJP. Do you agree with this, because this polarization of votes, especially in Uttar Pradesh, is benefiting these two parties largely?
I can't say that. I don't really know, since I don't know Uttar Pradesh politics very well. But I can say one thing, that there's a lot wanting as far as the Samajwadi Party government is concerned. The fact that you first allow something to happen, for example, that Yatra, apparently something was allowed first and then it was stopped.
Well, I met the VHP leaders.
Yeah. That's what I mean. The main leader goes and meets and then they say it's allowed and then they find that it's leading to a communal tension. I mean, any ordinary person will tell you that the whole purpose of this Yatra, 6 months before a national election and 3 months before state elections, is only meant for a particular purpose, because for 4 years they never thought of, Bhagwan Ram or anything else, and they suddenly start thinking of it in every election just 6 to 8 months before an election. That was very clear. It had political connotations. Even subsequent to that, even in this case, for example, some, instance took place in between members, between a girl being teased and, some firing happening, in which they happened to be from different religions. And please remember, teasing and that kind of violence is nothing that is peculiar or particular to people of any particular faith. I think all Indians get involved in all this. So it was an instance of a local law and order issue. But the fact is that it got exacerbated. Some Mahapanchayat of first one community took place, then another. I think very clearly, if the government had so desired, you should not have allowed these Mahapanchayats to happen. So you probably, allowed things to happen because you didn't want to take the kind of steps any normal administration would take. So it does at least show us that perhaps, they were not as forthcoming, and as strong as an administration should have been. And maybe that's why this unfortunate whole scenario has happened.
So would you call Mulayam Singh the Modi of Uttar Pradesh? Because, he's doing the same thing, playing the same kind of polarization politics the way Modi played in Gujarat.
I would not go to certain extent. I don't think, you can compare these two people. I would say that...
And different vote banks, but same method.
Of course, different ideologies, and therefore different type people with different kind of thinking get attracted to
others. But the method is the same, isn't it? You polarize the
vote. I won't say that, Samajwadi Party or somebody plays around with these emotions all the time. You can always give certain symbols to either group or the other, but I think they are very substantially different, At the maximum, you can say is that, they are sometimes, they are not able to understand or grasp an issue as it emerges. Whereas I think on the part of the BJP, there is active involvement, both in starting certain things like that, and once it happens, into propagating them and ensuring that they carry on. So I think it's very different.
Also, I've noticed, you know, whenever Modi attacks, in his speeches, whichever, even in the local assembly speeches, his targets are always the top three of the Congress. You know, he attacks the PM, Sonia and Rahul. But neither of these three have taken on Modi. Is this a planned strategy of the Congress?
No, because he's scared of them and they are not.
No, but, you know, you have as to answer some charges. This ABCD
As I said, this is just somebody who, you know, he's trying all kinds of things. He's trying his development plan, which kind of got punctured. Then he tried some Gujarat model, which got punctured. Then he tried to attack the, NDA with UPA, which doesn't seem to be taking anywhere. So now he's making it more and more personal. I mean, for example, this remark that after G20, Prime Minister did not make any remark. I mean, what is that statement all about? I mean, for example, if Prime Minister had made a statement on G20, they would have said, what is this? He's talking about G20, not something else. I mean, look at the kind of a street leader kind of character of this comment. So I don't think it's here or there. I think he is basically just trying to find certain elements which he believes may make him more popular with certain sections. And would like to, make new statements. But I don't take his statements very seriously.
How long can your top leadership also ignore Modi? Because
why should we respond to anybody? You see,
but he is going to be their face for the
next
Lok
Sabha. Remember, please,
we are incumbent.
We are the incumbent government. 9.5 years have gone by of UPA. When we will go to the polls, it will be 10 years. So we have to go to people with our performance. We have to go to people with our accomplishments. Our government cannot get voted back onto how bad somebody else is or our challenger is. A government has to be voted by the record it has kept and by the promise it gives for the future. And I believe our record has been fairly good given all the circumstances. And I think what we are brought in the last 1 year in terms of legislation is just outstanding. Our only problem is we are not as vocal or as propagandist as perhaps many of the others are. And therefore, what we do comes out 9 rather than 11 in terms of our achievements.
But then you're not vocal also because your top leadership doesn't communicate. Neither of these three have held a press conference in recent times. They don't talk to the media. Prime Minister only talks when he's going on a plane, going somewhere or coming back. I mean, the communication has to start from the top. Now Rahul is going and talking at rallies and saying,
in all his rallies does.
Only rallies, but what about Parliament?
No, but let me ask
he never
you,
speaks
no,
in
no.
Parliament.
But even in Mr. Modi's case, has he held a press conference? I mean, I don't remember a press conference in the last 8-10 years, have you? Where he has sat down and actually, answered questions on his growth, model growth. I mean, I was very surprised. You know, I was also a student in my life. When somebody came to my college, there was a cross-questioning. I mean, what he does in certain colleges is just a lecture. In fact, more than a lecture, a political speech. So, I mean, just because a person speaks more often and says it in a dramatic fashion does not mean he's speaking substance, more than what he's saying. But I think what, in terms of Mrs. Gandhi or Rahulji or Prime Minister, I think whenever there is a critical moment, they make their what they are thinking through. For example, Rahulji in Delhi yesterday very clearly spoke of why the food security bill is necessary, why a land legislation has happened, why the Congress has changed the whole paradigm of development thinking from development as goals to development as a right. And I think it was a substantial statement he made yesterday.
But Rahul, again, his statements are a bit boring. His speeches are a bit bland. You need to get more active. You need to get more interactive with
That's your point of view. Everybody has a style and that's a point of view. Some people believe that a sedate, seriously said statement ultimately has greater value than something that is said with a lot of drama. So I think it's a point of view. Some people may like a particular style. Some people have a different style. So I think let's not get into these are all a lot of personal styles and things like that. I think what is important is what you say. And whether what you've said is actually making sense both to you and to your experience from the field and to how he's arguing and creating a particular logic. And I feel that is good and that is solid and that is based with the support of evidence and that is based with the support of conviction, then I think it's important.
But for how long can the Congress leadership ignore Modi? He's there, he's in your face. I mean, he's saying, I'm there, I've thrown my hat in as a prime ministerial contender. But
let him, he's there. You see, our main thing is how long will the polity of India ignore the achievements of UPA? I think one day, the tremendous, stupendous achievements of UPA will ultimately come out. And I think for us, that is our main weapon going into the election. The fact that, you've had 9 years of great growth, we've had one or two bad years, but as Prime Minister said, one or two bad years don't make the whole sum. See the overall thing of what we've done. See the legislation we brought in. I just want to give you a point here. One of the interesting criticism or two criticism that always happens about MGNREGA is that MGNREGA is having a bad impact on prices because it has led to rise in agriculture wages across India. And the fact that Punjab and Haryana and Uttar Pradesh are not getting labor because no labor is coming from Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, right? These are two valid criticisms. I think these two criticisms show what a tremendous impact MGNREGA has had. The fact that agriculture wages have gone up to very high levels across India, the fact that migration has gone down. Now, these ultimately, across different schemes, I'm just talking of MGNREGA since it's a much talked about scheme, are something
that's talked about by Rahul Gandhi
and everybody else, both for positive and negative. Those who understand and feel its reality, feel it. And those others who don't really know what MGNREGA is all about, just kind of, talk of any kind of propaganda that they may have heard. The fact is that these schemes on ground have made a huge impact. Look at the achievements of all the various schemes. I mean, even if numbers don't speak, look at the stories coming from the field.
No, I'll tell you what speaks. It's the numbers and stories are fine, but you need a face to sell these stories. The Congress doesn't have a face. You know, you keep saying we are going to go into elections. Who is your Prime Minister candidate? Manmohan Singh has said, let Rahul come. I will happy to be working under Rahul as PM. But there is no Rahul. So there is this big question mark as to
where. Let me take you back in 2003-04. I think that's the first time we came. We didn't have a face for Prime Minister. Mrs. Gandhi led the campaign. And in the tradition of the Congress, we always say that our leaders lead our campaign. Ultimately, it is the members of the parliamentary party and the top leadership that decides the leadership.
But right? In 2009
also, nobody...
No, it was Manmohan Singh. I remember that press
said,
conference.
No.
Sonia Gandhi ne wo manifesto pe haath rakha tha. She put the face and said, this is Manmohan Singh is the face.
Is the face. Prime Minister. Yeah, face is different. Not, she did not say that.
Quibbling on semantics.
There's a difference. No,
I know you're a Stephen's graduate.
We always say who our faces are. Who are the people going to lead our campaign? Very clearly, some months ago, Mr. Gandhi was made chairperson of the campaign committee. He is one of the primary leaders of the Congress. He, the Prime Minister and Mrs. Gandhi will lead the campaign nationally and our state leaders will lead the campaign statewise. Very clearly, these are our faces. But are these faces only going to be the ones becoming Prime Minister? I mean, as a congressman, if you ask me, I would say it is every congressman's dream that one day Rahul ji becomes Prime Minister, hopefully as soon as possible, sooner than other than later. But that apart, it's ultimately for the party's top leadership to decide when the new members of parliament will come post 2014, when we will be ready to form the next government, then our members of parliament will decide.
Is it not that the Congress wants to avoid a Rahul versus Modi fight? That's why you're not naming him?
It's not a matter of avoiding. I mean, they have named somebody. They are so keen to make it a Mr. Modi versus whoever it is. It's up to them to decide who they want versus who. I don't think it's a matter of any one person versus another person. It's a matter of what we have done. The kind of ideas with which we are going into the next election, the combination of the large number of highly competent people that make up the Congress leadership at the national level, at the state, Mrs. Gandhi and Rahulji's own persona, their pro-poor image, the fact that these two have held the party together, that they are basically democratic in nature, they are pro-poor in nature, they brought a kind of legislation that perhaps independent Indian has never seen before. I think these are some great achievements of both these leaders, and I'm sure when they will go to the public, these achievements will be re-emphasized and it will also give us a political benefit.
Now, you're talking about a lot of competent leaders in the Congress. Why not in the BJP, a three-time chief minister can aspire to be prime minister, but in the Congress, neither say the Delhi CM, take the Assam CM, we have so many CMs who are competent, but nobody can aspire to be prime minister.
See, in our party, nobody aspires to be prime minister. It is the leadership and the parliamentary party that ultimately decide. I think we do have a slightly different way of looking at things. You know, in many other parties, there may be people
in your
who
party,
may be...
no one wants to be Prime Minister, Sandeep.
No,
Rahul
that.
Doesn't,
no,
Sonia
no,
doesn't.
Not that. How do you say that? I mean,
you are saying the CMs don't.
In our basic training,
Manmohan ne bhi mana kar diya.
But actually, in our basic training, we are not people who will go out and voice our ambition. First of all, I think most of us are trained to have humble ambitions because working is first and foremost something that we are trained in Congress to concentrate towards. Being pro-poor, voicing the voice of the poor to the any echelon we need to take it on. I think that is the basic training from where a congressperson comes. What we could become, what our ambitions would be is always secondary. Maybe in some other parties this is what you want to become, far more important than how you become. I think it's with us, how we can become, and we, not I, how we can become, how we can come back to power, how we can serve Indians better, I think is far more important than which one of us will become when we become.
Okay, last question about you yourself. How did you join politics? You were not, was it a planned thing?
My mother being in politics obviously opens much easier route for you to get into politics, you know, and I won't deny that. But the thing is that, I was only involved in politics through whatever political interaction one ever had. But I think it is what happened in Gujarat in 2002, and I was working in an NGO in Madhya Pradesh. But that kind of made me question myself, and you know, and I won't deny that. But the thing is that, I was only involved in politics through whatever political interaction one have had. But I think it is what happened in Gujarat in 2002. And I was working in an NGO in Madhya Pradesh. But that kind of made me question myself and let me think as to, could I keep off an area where I would really think, you know, people need to go into after what's happened. And I thought it was an event that perhaps could change or could impact Indian polity for a long while. And I think that was one of the things that spurned me to look more seriously at politics. Then, of course, 2000 came, 4 came, an opportunity came, and then I took the opportunity.
But you also, you know, I know that you are very fond of, you do the Dandiya every year, for instance. Do you get the time for all that?
Little bit. I mean, I am actually very fond of a lot of cultural activities. I used to do a lot of theatre. That I did for 2-3 years even after becoming an MP, but that kind of I dropped. Then there are a lot of these cultural things I keep getting involved in. I mean, that's actually a lot of my personal thing. But I keep them because, you know, you do need to have a life of your own. And I think what I do with my cultural activities and through, I mean, I do a bit of running and sports every day. So I think that just keeps me content and happy.
Well, that's a good note to end this on. Thank you so much for talking to NewsX, Sandeep.
Thank you.
Well, that was Sandeep Dikshit launching an all-out attack on Narendra Modi on behalf of his leader, Rahul Gandhi. Now moving on to the big story of the week, we take a look at the rise of Narendra Modi in the making of a leader.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
On his 63rd birthday, Narendra Modi most certainly thinks he can. A lesser politician would have been consumed by the politics of hatred. But Narendra Modi has risen from the embers of Gujarat 2002 like the proverbial phoenix. It doesn't matter if he is campaigning for a state election in Chhattisgarh or Rajasthan. Modi's targets are always national, not local.
Modi's target may be the top three of the Congress leadership, but the Congress strategy is to treat him like just another BJP chief minister, like a pretender and not a national contender.
Why should we equate Rahul Gandhi with Narendra Modi? Narendra Modi is a state leader. He has not proved his worth anywhere outside Gujarat.
This was the Congress strategy when Modi was just another BJP chief minister. This is also the reason why Modi was in such a hurry to get himself promoted as the BJP's prime ministerial face. Modi, the PM aspirant, has also refashioned a new tag for his brand of politics, from Hindutva to Moditva. This is a brand that harps both on development and fundamentalism.
We are corruption proof. Arbon kharbon rupiya kharch karke TV pe advertisement de rahe hain. Bharat ke nirman pe hak hai mera. Log kehte hain Bharat ke nirman pe shak hai mera.
It's been a long yatra for BJP's latest yatri. Ironically, he was LK Advani's first sarthi when the BJP patron undertook his famous Somnath to Ayodhya Rath Yatra in 1990. Later, he accompanied Murli Manohar Joshi to Srinagar in the former's Ekta Yatra and delivered what is now a patented Modi speech, high on drama, rhetoric and nationalism. What also comes across in this speech is the famed Modi arrogance. This heightened sense of self was visible even in the 90s, at a time when Modi was nowhere being the cult figure he is today.
Madhuravji Sindhya ka jo accident ho gaya hai, usme unke saath ek patrakar cameraman hai Gopal, uska bhi swargvas hua hai. To main us Gopal ke funeral mein aaya hu.
Fortunately for Modi, the BJP leadership had as much faith in him as he had in himself. In October 2001, when Keshubhai Patel, the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, was losing control of the state, Vajpayee sent him there as Chief Minister. Modi took office 6 months after Gujarat was ravaged by the 2001 earthquake. Unfazed, he grabbed the challenge. Of course, being Modi, he didn't hesitate to advertise his achievements.
लातूर के भूकंप से गुजरात का भूकंप 400 गुना ज्यादा नुकसान करने वाला था। लेकिन मैं कहता हूं आप में से कोई टीम बनाइए, लातूर के भूकंप के बाद लातूर का डेवलपमेंट देखिए और कच्छ के भूकंप के बाद 6 साल के भीतर कच्छ में क्या परिवर्तन आया है।
Unfortunately for Modi, his image as the Messiah man didn't last long. A month later, on 27 February 2002, a train load of car saviours were returning from Ayodhya to Gujarat on the Sabarmati Express. A mob surrounded the coach carrying the car saviours and torched them to death. This was followed by the retaliatory Gujarat riots which targeted Muslims in Gujarat. As Chief Minister, Modi's role in this pogrom is still under cloud.
Chief Minister ke liye मेरा एक ही संदेश है कि वो राज धर्म का पालन करें, राजा के लिए शासक के लिए प्रजा प्रजा में भेद नहीं हो सकता।
वाजपेयी may have reprimanded Modi, but the hardcore Hindutva brigade embraced him as their icon and the tallest leader of the Hindu right. The Surabuddin fake encounter controversy that followed only added to Modi's larger than life image as the hero of hatred.
Encounter.
But wherever there is Modi, the political rhetoric inevitably shifts to the politics of divide. This is the one reason why Advani and co. have been opposing Modi's elevation. But such is the Modi aura that any tirade, any invective heaped against him only seems to strengthen the Modi mystique. Some would say he subtly encourages such attacks, knowing these would make him stronger.
Moditva has no clear formula. Just when you think he's packaging himself as the next best Vajpayee, Modi will come up with a puppy analogy or a comment like the Barkha of secularism. After all, this is a man who thinks he has a date with destiny and is pulling out all stops to ensure that he keeps it.
Well, love him or hate him, but you simply cannot ignore Narendra Modi. That is all from us this week. Thank you for watching Cover Story and see you again next week.